right, Hakan Kjellberg, Anticimex Sweden. Welcome to the show. Hakan, good to have you.
Good to be here.
Hakan, how did you and your company experience the COVID-19 crisis? How did it hit you, not only in Sweden, but also internationally?
From Anticimex perspective, we were hit since we're a worldwide company, we were hit on several occasions. It started out very much in Asia and then moved further west, came to Europe, and we had huge problems. Our countries were very affected, was both Italy and Spain in the early days. And from my perspective, sitting in Sweden, we had a lot of people, tourists actually went down to Italy during the first, hectic times, and that was also perhaps a risk or explanation why, Stockholm area was a lot of cases of COVID-19 early on. But we have been, and later on, it's been in the U.S. market. They have the lockdowns from New York and down. So, I mean, we have been affected in a very much same way as everybody else. We were taken by surprise, as I think everybody else was. So. But it has to be stay as normal as you can in a very unnormal times.
Yeah. I would really like to know, we started our discussion a bit before we hit the record button about disinfection. And I think if we're looking at LinkedIn, if we're looking at Pest Magazine, if we're looking at what people do in Italy, in Spain, in America, in China, we see people disinfecting like crazy. What do you, your business, think about disinfection, or is this question maybe does it have plenty of answers because you're a multinational company?
It do have plenty of answers because we have different cultures all around the world, yeah. And we are we're seeing this from different points of view. So from a Scandinavian perspective, there's not been a market or driven by the markets. The disinfection services, because it's not common culture to do that. It's just they have been very, very strong in the message from the authorities around in Scandinavia. Said the routine, the regular cleaning and routine disinfection of everyday, daily work, that's the most important, and stay home if you're sick and so on. Mm-hmm. But we can see from pictures from our company and that the other companies or countries have had a totally different approach to disinfection and have done it in large scale. Mm-hmm. They have also been more affected by the COVID-19, by death tolls and so on. So understandable. I think we have seen it from different side of the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny. We already found out that countries like Scandinavia or Germany, maybe Austria, Switzerland, it accounts for them as well, have been rather defensive or not a lot of businesses or people do see disinfection with, machines and fogging machines and not just the tiny hand sprays, but really machinery where you disinfect whole buses or, schools or governmental buildings, food industry. It's very very common, let's say in US American or Asian or maybe Israeli countries, is not in our areas. It's quite interesting, isn't it? I mean, yeah. I think it will probably make a lot of sense to regularly disinfect. We just had a discussion about that. Yeah. And maybe you want to elaborate a little bit about your opinion on that matter.
As you write, Daniel, a lot of the routines and the routine cleaning and routine disinfection of services, that's something that should be done very extremely frequent when we talk about COVID-19 and to prevent the disease from spreading. Mm-hmm. And that has been communicated from our authorities and in the hospital sector and so on. So, but they are doing it. I mean, you can imagine a doctor or nurse meeting an infecting person. They start just by washing their hands for 5 minutes. They use the hand disinfection products. They dress up and they do everything they can to be proactive and preventative. Mm. And after the patient has left the room, the examination room, they do exactly the same again. I mean, they start cleaning and they start doing the process all over again. And that has been repeated from every single day, every single patient, and so on. And that is what I see is the most, I mean, that's the disinfection, how it should be, a combination with cleaning and disinfection. And from a preventative perspective, I think it's important to do it at the higher frequency than before. And then sometimes you can do this more of disinfection if someone is rather scared or afraid of the COVID-19, and perhaps you're starting up your business again after it has been in a lockdown for several weeks. That is, I think there's a great need for doing a one-off treatment with disinfection services.
Totally agree.
Yeah,
I think it has a lot to do not only with let's say the virus and how much does it make sense from a virology standpoint, but also in terms of security, and transporting security and transparency to your employees, to your staff, but also to your clients, so they have some sort of security to re-enter facilities again, right?
Yeah, and I mean, we can see differences all around the world in how we have been handling this situation, both by using disinfection products or not in a large scale. But we can also remember sometimes that there has been dramatic differences in how many people that has been affected. Mm. I mean, Sweden is still, I mean, even if someone around the world, no names, but say this is a horrible example of how to handle the COVID-19 situation, we can see other countries, of course, they have more inhabitants than Sweden, but still they have large numbers of affected people.
In percent. And
in percent. Yeah. And that's also, I mean, how would you react if you were the boss of a president or prime minister or someone is running the show and say, what will your next step or move be if you don't have all the facts on the table? Mm-hmm. Could it be like that? Yeah, we can see the numbers are increasing. What can we do for stopping it or an action we do think can be of great success, but we don't know yet. But are you willing to not do it, or are you willing to take a chance?
Yeah.
I think we can see a lot of brave persons out there, and we've also seen a lot of persons have not been as brave.
100% agree. I also want to take account of what you said earlier, which I found really, really interesting, and I would like to ask you to explain a little bit further, although it seems probably obvious, is what you said is pests do not care about COVID-19.
They're not. I say it could be actually an increase of pests because of if people are not getting to work and do what they normally do for a living. Yeah. Suddenly we have some areas in the society where pests can like proliferate and just expand. They can use this. We can see it from a daily life. We see reports of dolphins swimming into the harbor of Venice. We can see other wild animals are like claiming back the streets in some parts of the world and so on. So, why shouldn't rats, why shouldn't birds or pest birds or do the same thing? I mean, they're living together with us humans all the time. And suddenly we were like more in-house. We were not disturbing them as much as we did before. So why shouldn't the number of pests actually grow and expand?
Obviously, and you also mentioned a couple of examples, the face of pest control and how it's being recognized by, let's say, our culture in every single country around the world. The face of pest control might be changing because we're dealing with things like zoonosis, with rodents, with cockroaches, with birds and mosquitoes every day. And I would like your opinion on that one as well.
Yeah, I mean, we were all taken by surprise sort of COVID-19, but as I early on, as we stated, that our pest control industry is dealing with sometimes even more hazardous things when it comes to the, like, viruses and microorganisms related to rats or birds,
yeah,
that we face on a daily basis. We look into bait stations, we look into removing dead bodies of dead rodents, removing bird poo from buildings and so on. And those things are actually containing a lot of what we call hazardous waste or viruses and bacteria and so on.
I'll just continue, no worries.
Yeah. So we were early on say, this is just normal business for us. We need to continue and face that we have. We are dealing with risk every single day of pest control. So this is just adding a new format to it or adding a new factor to it.
100% agreed. Yeah. For me personally, you know, as you know, this channel, this interview series or podcasts for us means really giving pest control a face, you know, with the people from the industry, but also changing our reputation. For us, it's really important. As CEPA also quoted the good pest manager. We want to make pest control and the reception of it really more professional. I think that really pays into that, let's say, branding of our sector so much more because, I don't know, I imagine you had a small coffee shop or some hip place or t-shirt brand. It's probably not the best time to be in business right now. But us pesties, maybe a little bit effect for some people. You know, some people think it's disgusting what we do. But I'm really proud about what we do. And you just, you know, with what you said, I think it really comes to the surface that what we do is inherent to our society and human health.
Yeah. Now, I totally agree with you. I mean, people look at pests from, you can look at it from different angles. I choose my angle and say that pests are related to our health. So if we're not handling pests in a good way, it could be a health perspective from misusing pesticides or biocides. It could be also letting them thrive, like letting pests within your apartment or building and have been like affected by their presence because they are spreading. We know that the cockroaches spread to allergic diseases or allergic substances. We have rodents running from dirty to clean surfaces, spreading salmonosis and leptospirosis. We have the birds around us. We have the mosquitoes in some areas. So I mean, it's a matter of, like, if you want to be really, really passionate about it, you can say it's a matter of life and death.
Yes. I think so too. Our sector is named pest control. That comes from the pest, obviously, that has been there once. It's so long ago that we really can't imagine it nowadays anymore, how the pest really affected our globe, but it was crazy. And the pest still is active in countries like Madagascar, for instance. And I think a global pandemic, although it's a virus, it's tiny, we can't see it, is comparable to what we do on a daily basis. So I think, you know, what we're doing and the importance of it also being recognized as key industry was, you know, really good for our sector, in my honest opinion. I hope it will thrive and continue. Did you Swedes, the Swedish country, did it account you guys for a key industry from the beginning?
No, they were a little bit reluctant to identify because we have like 290 communes, which is like a regional government, so to say, or really, and you had to describe your own business in a way that you are seen as someone that needs to be in the society, even if we have rough times. So we just did our own analysis and said, yes, me and my colleagues and our president said, of course, we are a company that provides services that needs to be ongoing, even if we have COVID-19. So we were just writing a letter to everyone that really asked for a letter, but we have not so far. I don't think we have actually been like have had any problems with that. So we continue our business.
And did you, may I ask, did your suddenly, did your strategy in Sweden or in any other country change at all? I mean, it's probably a very tough question to ask because you're a multinational business, but I think in some countries you probably did a 180 and focused on disinfection, and some other countries business as usual, but overall?
Yeah, I think we were a little bit in different parts of the world. We changed a little bit of the took the opportunity and also did a very good job in providing the market with the service they were asking for. So we, on that basis, yes, we did. In some other parts, like slow growing Scandinavia or more laid back Scandinavia, perhaps we didn't manage to create a market because the demand was quite low. But at the same time, we looked at the future and see what can we do, what is the next step, how should we communicate pests from a new angle, or do we need to promote it from a new angle, or should we just continue to talk about pests related to illness and sickness and viruses and so on, and the damage they can cause.
Because nobody wants to be opportunistic and create populism, right? Just making money out of a virus with fear is just, you know, crazy. And I think nobody in our industry really wants to do that. But how do you sensibly use the platforms that we have to engage with our community and client network and inform them, because they know we have to do with bacteria and viruses every day? I think it's quite a balance act, really, right?
Yeah, it is. And we would like the term like knowing, not guessing. And that's something we use for pests in general. But it also comes down to COVID-19 and what do we know and what are we guessing? Yeah. So we try to provide our customers a lot of facts. And they were asking, we were giving them what we knew about the COVID-19 and how to react. So we did early on when the regulation said so. So we helped our customers to deal with a little bit of being supportive when it came to the risk assessment, because they were like aiming for the food industry or restaurants and specials, especially because they were, if you are to be open, you have to do something to reduce risk of your guests catching or spreading the COVID-19. So we were part of, some of our customers helped them out with identifying the risk by seeing where are your lines of guests, where are they lining up, do you see any like patterns in that one? So we actually helped them in doing that. And also a lot of trainings. We had webinars for customers just providing what we knew about it and how to handle it. So I think we, in a very traditional and Anticimex Scandinavian way, provided a lot of facts. The customer had to make their own decisions and assumptions.
We just had a very philosophical and kind of intro to our discussion when we said, or when you said, which is also one of your company's slogans, knowing, not guessing, which I really like, because we said, you know, numbers and figures and information are always retrospective. So looking back at the past, and then you have to be brave, as you indicated earlier with the political heads of our nations. You have to be brave to take a step further into the future, assume what's going to lay in the future, what makes sense on a probability scale, and then move ahead further. I know Anticimex is using a lot of smart devices, digital devices and digital traps, digital monitors, whatever. And knowing, not guessing, comes from that digital experience of yours. So how does that strategy change, grow, decrease during COVID-19?
We've been asked by some of our customers, how can we help them if they close down, for example, how can we monitoring their premises without even being there? And we said, yes, we have smart. We can do it from a distance. We can set up a monitoring system that helps you to identify something if like rodents are moving around your premises and you're not present. So we had like small packages or solutions for customers like that that were really concerned and saw us as a partner, really partner in doing that. And it was big multi international companies that asked for that one. So I think the smart Anticimex smart portfolio there is like or the concept of monitoring online is absolutely something for in this time of COVID-19, because we don't have to be there. We reduce our risk for our own employees not being there, but we can also monitoring the pests regularly and just take action when needed, when the threshold is above what's accepted.
Yeah, and I think you in your annual report, your CEO, Jarl, and also, by the way, of your main competitor, Rentokil, Andy Ransoms, the CEO, highlighted that, smart or digital is going to be one of the key investments of your businesses for the upcoming years. And now, new news, by the way, of Rentokil also reached us where Andy Ransom committed that or communicated that mergers and acquisitions is slowing down or deceasing completely for the moment now. So I think when you're trying to grow with capital to increase your turnover by mergers and acquisitions, when this is stopping, I think there is a logical next step. Growing your business with incremental sales and incremental new technologies like smart connect or whatever it's named. So I think that's what you just said is really complementing to how the big players in the market are.
I think it goes for the whole pest control industry is how to develop your existing customers, because we know that pests can be there's always a way or almost always a way to develop and existing customers, because you have the confidence, you have the connections, you have everything in place already. So how can you use that knowledge and use your connections in creating a better day, both for your customers, say your point of view, and for yourself?
Yeah. So one of my questions that I think a lot of people are interested to learn more about would also be, how did you guys change your work system? I mean, you're working from home right now. Many people, of course, field staff, sales can't really too much work from home. Technical staff needs to go out and perform pest control where there's no smart devices installed.
Yeah.
How did the remote situation change your business and the way you guys work and the team effects and, you know, everything?
Yeah, we have been advised by our authorities. So if you can do your home work from home, you should do that. And some are our business can be done from home without any problems. So like I and my colleagues, we are a group of specialists dealing with food safety, fire protection, pests all day long. So we work from home, connected by Skype or any other office teams or whatever it is. We have done, apart from regular like meetings and work meetings, we have had celebrated one person's my employee's birthday. We have had breakfast meetings and so on. So, and I know other persons within Anticimex, they have that ordinary coffee stop at like 1500 hours in the afternoon to just turn on the Skype and sit down with a cup of coffee. So I think we have managed in a good way. Sweden has also a very good infrastructure when it comes to good connectivity. So we have not seen any problems in being connected via Skype or sharing files or wherever. So there was a little bit of problematic in the beginning before the companies providing the services realized that, people are really using our services. But I can see it has been a lot more stable since looking back 5 weeks.
Mm. Yeah, I agree. It's always, COVID-19 wasn't to be expected. And then when you have to scale your video communications tool or messaging tool or, Scrum task management tool or whatever from today to next week, it's really, really, really hard and challenging. So
we also like done a lot of webinars, as I mentioned before, and that has also been very, I mean, people have really enjoyed it. So customers have like signed up for it and just took part.
Yeah, I think so too. And honestly, I mean, we're living in 2020, and I said it earlier in another video. In 1914, Henry Ford introduced the 8-hour work week, and we have still not changed, although we have these smartphones and these smart thingies that let us work from all around the world very efficiently. So I think I personally stand for a world that is called meritocracy, where it's really a meritocracy means it, you're, it's measured due to efficiency and not to hours you spend at a place. Because the average worker works 3 hours per day, the average. So let's just work efficiently and measure our efficiency instead of the hours we put in, right?
Now, I would like to see, like, if you look at from a perspective, if we look back 6 months from now and say, what, or even 1 year from now, and say, what changes did we make during the COVID-19 that still exists? Some of them can be perhaps using these video meetings more widely than used before. Perhaps washing your hands has been more of like common, and you, how to wash your hands. So I think it would be interesting to see what will be the long lasting effects of
This is if you're going to find time, we're gonna have some guests that we're gonna try to speak to every 2 or 3 months. So I really would like to revisit that topic with you.
Bring it back.
Last but not least, Hakan, I mean, this is a wild guess here, but what do you think? How do you think the virus and everything that's happening with the financial crisis is affecting our industry? Not only the multinationals that have already put out profit warnings for their, you know, stocks and private equities, but also the small, mid-sized company, 1, 2, 3, 10, 15, 20, 50 employees.
I can see a big difference in different types of businesses. I know the hotel industry, they will have a hard time in coming back to normal again, I think, because they just overnight they just lost everything. And then you had from Swedish perspective, we have continuously, we have had some food establishments ongoing, so they have not been, I mean, of course people are not been present because they have lost a lot of customers, but still they have done some of they have provided some services, but also we can, like, some of our customers have a very explosion when it comes to selling services or like in the food sector, like food. So I think we can see different segments having hard time to get back than others, but of course we have been affected. Everyone, there's no single person that has not been affected, I think. And it will take time before everything is back to normal, if it ever gets back to normal.
Last but not least, do you read the study that was some scientists in France examined whether cockroaches can carry COVID-19 as a zoonosis and, you know, spread it further? As I read the title of it, I was like, oh my god, this is going to be the new pest if that really happens. But unfortunately, it was said that, or proven that
I haven't read it, but I mean, we know that pests are, like, they're living right around us, and everything we carry, they can carry. And the $1 million question is if the virus can it survive within the body of a cockroach or any other pests, as with other microorganisms, and that may become a reservoir or something like transporting the diseases to new areas, or even like, can it mutate and become something even worse?
Yeah, that's a $1 million question. Hakan, we're going to revisit all of that in 2 to 3 months. For now, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.